Jesus, you are my life. Hallelujah. You are everything. Say, Jesus, you are everything to me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Anybody need him? That are going on in the lives of people who believe the Lord. That just kind of overwhelmed me this week about just situations and things that believers are going through. And real life stuff. Some of those things that have been birthed years ago, things that have happened years ago still affecting some believers, some children of God. And talking this week about the incorruptible seed of Jesus, God burned my heart this week to share a word to you from 2 Samuel. This story is about the grandson of Saul. You know, Saul was the first king. Saul had a son named Jonathan. And Jonathan and Saul both were killed in battle at the same time. And, you know, God, when the people asked God for a king, God chose a king for the people. And the king that he chose was Saul. And Saul rebelled against God. He lost the anointing that God had placed upon his life. But it didn't matter to God, he was still God's king.
Right.
David knew that. David wouldn't put his hands on Saul because he was not going to touch the anointed of God. So you got to be careful when you touch God's anointed. You got to be very careful when you put your mouth on the man or the woman of God. Folk got to be careful putting their mouth on you because you are a man or a woman of God. Sometimes when people say that, folk be thinking they're talking about the preacher. But you, a child of God, he made us all priests. People got to be careful putting their mouth on you because you are the anointed of the Lord. Amen?
Amen?
Well, here in this story, amen, when the Lord burned my heart this week with the life situations that the children of God are going through, he took me to 2 Samuel 4 and 4. It says, and Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son that was lame of his feet. He was 5 years old when the tidings came to Saul and Jonathan out of Jezreel, and his nurse took him up and fled. And it came to pass that she made haste to flee, that he fell and became lame. And his name was Mephibosheth. Well, I practiced that name all week. Got him, forgot how I pronounced it. Mephibosheth. And Mephibosheth was 5 years old. He was the son, of Jonathan. And when he got the news, when the family got the news that Saul, the king, and his son Jonathan was dead, they knew that the folks was coming after the family of Saul to kill him. And so they scooped up everything they could and they made haste to get out of there. And in making haste, this nurse that had taken care of this son all this year, this five-year-old boy, for 5 years, dropped him. Dropped him. And when she dropped him, it damaged his feet, broke his legs. And he was crippled the rest of his life. The person that took care of him, loved him, washed him, hugged him, probably when he was sick, took care of him, was the very one that dropped him. Some of you today are here. People that took care of you, loved you, washed you, looked after you, fed you, provided for you, dropped you. Dropped you. Many of us have situations where family members, friends, loved ones dropped us. You've been dropped. And you crippled from that fall. Lame from that fall. You know, when you're crippled, you don't walk right. And some reasons and some situations that folks have gone through got them in a position right now they're not walking right. And I'm not speaking of physically walking, I'm speaking of spiritually walking. When you look back on the fall that you took, somebody dropped you, somebody let you down, somebody hurt you, somebody broke you, something happened in your marriage, something happened with your mom and your daddy, something happened at school, something happened with the person that was taking care of you, something that they did to you, something that they damaged you with something that they did, and that's a drop. But I've come to tell you that you dropped, but you're not forgotten.
Amen.
Dropped, yet not forgotten.
Amen.
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 You dropped. Say, I'm dropped. I've been dropped. I tell you what, everybody in here been dropped.
Yes,
everybody in here, some situation in your life, you say, I was dropped. And sometimes we dropped ourselves. Sometimes we've had a fall and we've damaged ourselves. Sometimes we've been damaged by loved ones, damaged by friends, damaged by those who were close to us, like this nurse. Now, when we look at that situation, we say she should have been holding him better than that. She should have, if she dropped anything, it shouldn't have been him.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Drop anything, but don't drop my baby. You know, let go. You fall, but don't you fall and fall to where he land on top of you, but don't drop. He must have had a hard fall to damage at 5 years old his feet and his ankles and his legs to where they would never heal and to where he would be crippled and lame the rest of his life. A royal child, the child born in the family of a king, was dropped. So David, in 2 Samuel 9 and 1, David is here in this story. It says, and David said, is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul that I may show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? And there was of the house of Saul a servant whose name was David. And when they had called him unto David, the king said unto him, art thou Zeba? And he said, thy servant is he. And the king said, is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show kindness of God unto him? And Zeba said unto the king, Jonathan had yet a son which is lame at his feet. I tell you, you might be broken, you may be dropped, but you are not forgotten. Here David is. This story kind of take off from here. Don't say why God put this on David's heart or why God put this in David's heart at this particular time. But I'm telling you, you can be dropped but not forgotten. God got you on somebody's heart right now. God got you. God got you in somebody's heart right now. Praise God. Based on what you've gone through, you think it's over with. You think God has forgotten you. You think what has happened to you that God didn't identify, don't recognize it, don't know you've been hurt, don't know where you are, but God knows exactly where every one of us is. To God be the glory. Dropped, but yet not forgotten. Amen. And the king said unto him, where is he? Zeba said unto the king, behold, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel and Lodabar. Lodabar was a low place. It was an impoverished place. It was a place that was poor. And when Saul's family fled, they fled to a place in exile where nobody could find them. They went somewhere to hide out. They wanted to hide out. They didn't want anybody. He's living. Can you imagine coming from Saul's house, the king's house, receiving everything that you receive? All of a sudden, you live in. And pop, you crippled, you lame, you're in exile, and you're living in the poorest area. He's living in Lodabar, and that's a poor, impoverished area. And people who are dropped usually find a place to hide. People who have been dropped usually find somewhere to hide so nobody can get to them. You might not be hiding physically. You know, you may not be hiding to where people don't know exactly where you live, but you're hid in your spirit where nobody can get to you. Because you've been hurt, you've been dropped, and to you, you've been forgotten. Nobody's thinking about you, and the person that abused you or the person that hurt you, you know, they long gone or you know, they're no longer in the picture or whatever the case may be, and you yet still in Lodabar. You yet still in a place of exile. Praise God. And you hadn't realized even to this day that you are the son and the daughter of a king. Because you are a son and you are a daughter of a king. Matter of fact, you're the son and the daughter of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And you've been dropped, but you hadn't been forgotten. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, you've been dropped. Somebody dropped you. Somebody dropped you. Your mama, your daddy, your husband, your wife, amen. Your grandma, somebody dropped you on somebody, your school, at your school, somewhere you've been dropped and crippled. When you're dropped and you're damaged, you're crippled, you don't feel like going on, you don't walk the same way. You've lost your spiritual walk. You've lost your desire. You've lost your identity. You don't realize who you are. That boy was yet still Saul's grandson. Yes. He was yet still a royal child living in Lodabar. Yes. Amen. Yes. He was royalty, living in Lodabar, living in poverty, living in lack, living without, on the floor, couldn't get up for himself, couldn't move himself. Anybody that saw him could see he was lame, could see he was crippled, could see that his feet were damaged. People see you and they see you've been damaged. People see you, they see that something happened. They don't know what happened, but they see that something happened to you to put you in the place that you're in and put you in the Lodabar. You could be living in a nice house, but be in Lodabar. You can have a bank account full of money, but be in Lodabar. Amen. Amen. You can be Lodabar. Lodabar today is not defined by being in poverty. It's defined by being spiritually bankrupt. Spiritually depressed, spiritually down, can't lift yourself up like this boy was. He was crippled. He was lame. He couldn't get up, and everybody saw him. Even when they approached him and found him on the ground. Now, Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was coming to David. He fell on his face and did reverence, and David said, and he answered, "Behold, thy servant." I know I'm thankful that God don't use perfect people. Amen. Praise God. Because I qualify. Amen. Then the king called Ziba, Saul's servant, and said unto him, "I have given unto thy master's son all that pertained to Saul and to all his house." Said, listen, you know, David, God will touch somebody's heart.
Yes, he will.
God touched David's heart. Mm-hmm. And he had David to give to Saul's grandson everything that belonged to Saul. Uh-huh. This is crazy. Yeah. It's crazy because Saul was a man that tried to kill David. Uh-huh. If Saul had an opportunity to kill David, he'd have killed David. He tried the hardest to kill David. Now David is dead. Saul didn't kill him, but David is dead. Jonathan is dead. Saul and Jonathan are dead. Amen. Saul is dead. Jonathan is dead. And David, here David is, he is still allowing God to use him. And he tells Ziba, he said, "I'm going to give Saul's grandson everything that was his. All of his land, all of his inheritance, everything that we got stored up is going to be his." Isn't that something? So, you know, you don't have to worry about how God is going to do it. You don't have to worry about who God's going to use to do it. All you got to know that if you've been dropped, and we have been, that there is a place that God has for us. There's some stuff that God has for you that's waiting for you. Amen. Nobody else can get it. It don't belong to anybody else. It only belongs to you. Praise God. And so God told him, said, thou therefore and thy sons, Ziba said, you and your sons and thy servants shall till the land for him, and thou shalt bring in the fruit that thy master's son may have food to eat. He said, see, Ziba was one of Saul's servants back then. Yeah. And so Ziba now is the servant of Saul's grandson. And he said, you and your family, Ziba had a lot of kids. So you and your family going to till the ground for him. And y'all going to bring in his harvest so that he'll have meat on his table, food on his table. Isn't that something?
Hallelujah.
Dropped, but yet not forgotten. Drop you. I don't care where you are in your life. I don't care when you look back and you say, "This is where I am. This is what I've gone through. This is the." I was speaking with Minister Ford when the Lord put this in my spirit. He was talking about a little boy, one of his case situations, and he was giving me some details about this case. No names, but some details about it. And I was like, "Oh my God, that child been dropped." He'd been dropped. You see people acting certain ways and doing certain things, and you don't know what their story is. You don't know why they're acting the way they act. You don't know what they go home to. You don't know what they wake up to. You simply don't know just by looking at a person all the hell that they've been through.
Hallelujah.
You don't know what they did to make it. You don't know what they come out of. You don't know what they're living with or living through. You know, we have no idea.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you the person next to you can be going through all kind of hell right now.
Hallelujah.
And you'll never know it.
Yeah.
You'll never see it with the makeup. You'll never see it with the smile.
Hallelujah.
You'll never see it with the look on their face. You'll never see what people are going through right now. Right now. What they're going through, you'll never see it. They can smile, and they can be working in church and serving in church and doing all these wonderful things, and you never know that they are in the lower bar of their life. You'll never know that they've been dropped and that they are crippled because they're walking upright. They're walking with two good legs. They're speaking and they're smiling. You don't know that inside they are damaged. They are crippled. They are lame. And they don't know what to do. And they're in exile. Like this boy was. Head out. But I'm telling you, God is putting you on somebody's mind. This message is to let you know that you are on somebody's mind. That you are on somebody's mind right now. And that God is going to bring you out.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah.
God is going to bring you out.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Say, God's going to bring me out.
God's going to bring me out.
So Mephibosheth dwelled in Jerusalem, but he did eat continuously at the king's table. Now look, this is what God did. God brought him out, and he gave him everything that would belong to his father. Because remember, he was damaged, but God placed Saul's grandson, in David's heart, and David sent somebody to get him, and they brought him back, and David gave him everything that was his grandfather. He gave it to him. He didn't know about half the stuff he was getting, any of the stuff he was getting. Didn't know even why they were seeking him. He thought they were seeking to hurt him, seeking to kill him. And God was seeking to bless him. And then David told Zeba, you're going to work the fields. You and your family are going to work the fields. You was a master to his grandfather. Now you're going to be he was a servant to his grandfather. Now you're going to be a servant to him. And you're going to work the fields. You're going to bring in food so that he will have food on his table.
Yeah.
But look at what God said. God said, David said, the grandson is not going to sit at his own table. He said, he's going to sit at my table. So Mephibosheth dwelled in Jerusalem, for he did eat continuously at the king's table.
Amen.
And was lame on both his feet. Now I want to show you this. Everybody didn't eat at the king's table.
Mm-hmm.
The king's table was reserved for the king's son. Mm-hmm. But here it is, this boy, who was Saul's grandson, was invited to eat at the table of King David. Mm-hmm. And King David said he will always, he said, you don't have to worry about him eating.
Yeah.
He'll always have a seat at my table. Praise God. He will always have a seat at the king's table. Now, when you sit at the king's table, you place your feet under the table. So sitting at the king's table, you can't see what he's been through. His feet are under the table. And so when you're sitting at the king's table, you can't see that you've been crippled.
Yeah.
You can't see that you've been laid. You can't see that he's been dropped. Because he's at the king's table. And listen, he said he'll always, forever be at the king's table. He will always and forever have a seat at the king's table. Can I flip this around and show you how Adam, a name I can't pronounce, dropped us? how Adam dropped us in the garden. And when he dropped us in the garden, he caused an incorruptible seed to become corrupted. And we have been living in Lodabar for a long time. Even believers who have received God, who have received Jesus, have been living in the Lodabar of their life for a long time, just based on the fall that took place in the garden. That was a fall as well. The fall of man in the Garden of Eden, amen, caused us to be placed in exile. And because of the corruptible seed that's on the inside of us, amen, it's caused us to make some bad decisions. But one day, the same way that God placed in the heart of David, this grandson of Saul, he placed in his own heart about us and sent us Jesus. Amen. And listen, Jesus has done the same thing. It's just a picture of Jesus. It's just a picture. The whole story of this whole story I just shared with you. It's just a picture of Jesus. How we've been dropped. We were dropped in the Garden of Eden. We were dropped in life. Amen. Praise God. And then God sent us Jesus. And Jesus has come, amen, that we would be taken from the Lodabars of life. Every one of you be taken from the Lodabar of life, washed in the blood of Jesus, amen. And no matter how crippled we are, no matter how damaged we are, no matter how lame we are, amen, no matter what you've gone through, you are now sitting at the table of the Lord, amen. Praise God. Praise God. Say, I'm at the table of the Lord, amen. I'm at the table of the Lord, amen. And I'm at the, listen, and not only are my feet under the table, but my whole life is under the blood. Amen. Amen. My whole life is under the blood of Jesus. Amen. And everything that was taken, everything that God had purposed and planned for you, planned and purposed for Adam, amen, in the Garden of Eden, everything that God had planned for us, amen. For the Lord said, the heaven belongs to him, but the earth he has given to man. He said, the heaven is his, but the earth he's given to man. And he's given us dominion over this earth, amen. Everything that God had planned for us is back in place right now, amen. Has been returned to us, amen. Amen. That means right now, I don't have to live in Lodabar. I don't have to live depressed. I don't have to look back on my fall. I don't have to look back on being lame, amen. I don't have to look back at where I've come from, amen. Because I've been brought out. I've been brought out, amen. Amen. I'm brought out, amen. And I'm brought out, amen. And I'm sitting at the King's table. Amen. I ain't talking about B.B. King. Amen. I ain't talking about Elvis the King of rock and roll, amen. Not even talking about Martin Luther King. I'm talking about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. I'm talking about we are at the table of the Lord. Amen. And listen, at the table of God, the Bible says here, prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemy. Amen. Anybody, God ever did that for anybody? Amen. Praise God. Say a table. He'll prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemy. And your enemy can't even do you no harm. Amen. You can sit in peace in the presence of your enemy and eat your food. Amen. Because you're eating from the table of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Come on, give the Lord a hand. And eat it. And forever. Say forever. Forever you will be at God's table. It doesn't matter that somebody dropped you. Don't matter that you've been dropped. Doesn't matter that you've been crippled. Doesn't matter that you've been lame. Don't matter what your upbringing was like. Don't matter the decisions you made and the mistakes you made and the things you wish you could take back that you can't take back. It's already happened. You can't take them back. But God said he want to bring you out of that Lodabar place. He want to bring you out of that place of depression, that place of poverty, that place of lack, amen. That place you've been hiding, amen. That place that you're at right now. He said he want to bring you out. I want to bring you to the King's table, amen. He got a place for you, amen. And everything, listen, the boy didn't have to work his own field. God said he got people that's going to do stuff for you. He's got people that's going to take care of things that you won't need to take care of. All you got to do is rest and be seated at the table of the Lord. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Amen. I ain't got to dwell on being abused. I ain't got to dwell on being mistreated. I don't have to dwell on this person did this to me, that person did that to me. I don't have to dwell on good people that did bad things to me. Good people that meant good but dropped me. Amen. People that were supposed to be hugging me dropped me. People that were supposed to be loving me dropped me. I don't have to dwell on that. All I got to do now is see. Be seated at the table. And know that I am the son and the daughter of a king. Anybody know that? Say, I'm the son of a king. I'm the daughter of a king. Say, I'm the son of a king. I tell you, you are truly the son of a king. You are truly the daughter of a king. Amen. Praise God. Say, I'm not crippled anymore. Stand up with me. Amen. I'm not crippled anymore. Amen. Praise God. I'm not crippled by my past. I'm not crippled by what people have done to me. I'm not crippled based on the fall. Yeah, I took a fall, and it was a bad fall. But praise God for Jesus. Praise God that God has put you on somebody's mind. That God is sending some help for you. That God is bringing you out of the lowest of your life. And bringing you into a place where you have life and have it more abundantly, where you can sit at the table of the King. Praise God. You got a table to sit at. There's a place for you to sit at. But God said, I don't want you to sit at your own table. I want you to sit at my table. I don't want you to eat your own food. I want to provide the food that I want you to eat. Hallelujah. Only the King's sons and daughters sit at his table. Only his family sit at his table. Look at us. Come on, get a Lord a hand of praise. This ain't no makeup stuff. This ain't no make-believe stuff.
Hallelujah.
You're at the table of the Lord. You're at the table of the Lord. You can't live in Lodabar no more. Can't live there any longer. When they got the Lodabar, when David's posse got the Lodabar, and they went and told Saul's grandson that King David got some people here. And he said, what are they doing here? And they said, they looking for you.